I think we are just going live now. 2 minutes. Yes. Namaste, everyone. My name is Vaishali Shah. I welcome each one of you to our session on Hindu culture and lifestyle on our Facebook page, hindustriptures.com. I think we are late by 5 minutes as we were stuck on some other account. So before I start, let's do a small prayer. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Shakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. As promised, today we have Dr. Suchita Parajpe ji. Suchita, namaste ji. Kaise aap?
Bahut achhi. Thank you.
It's so nice to have her again. Last time we discussed about some other topic and it was a very, very interactive and interesting session. So today I thought of finding out more about women in scriptures. And, you know, today, nowadays, women are everywhere. They want to reach to the moon and they want to ensure that they conquer every world and every territory in the society. And that was the reason I wanted to know why women are what they are today and how they were in earlier times. So Dr. Suchita ji is going to talk about the stronger, I can't say feminism, though the title is feminism, but I feel the strong characteristics of women, how they were earlier and how they're supposed to be in today's time. She's going to tell us about it. Suchita ji, please.
Thank you. या देवी सर्वभूतेषु शक्तिरूपेण संस्थिता नमस्तस्यै 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 नमो नमः. इट वाज ओनली यस्टरडे दैट वी फिनिश्ड सेलिब्रेटिंग नवरात्रि, राइट? एंड व्हाट इज नवरात्रि? इट्स अ फेस्टिवल टू सेलिब्रेट एंड टू ऑनर द मदर गॉडेस. इट इज सरप्राइजिंग टू सी, यू नो, बाय द वे आई वोंट बी यूजिंग द वर्ड हिंदुइज्म because I'm going to speak only about the Vedic religion, especially the one which can be seen in Rigveda, and therefore I would use the word Vedic religion, okay? And Rigveda was composed in 3000 to 2500 BC, which means whatever I'm going to tell you relates back to an era which is 5,000 years back from today. So you can imagine what the condition, what was the role and position of women in society which is 5,000 years old. So anyway, we have many deities, female deities. And who are they? There is Aditi, Diti, Usha, Raka, Kuhu, Siniwali, and many others, you know. I will just enlist a few of them. Aditi is the most important of all. Aditi's sons are called Aditehe Adityaha. We know the word Aditya and they are Aditi's son. Aditi is very strong. In one of the suktas, sukta is a poem in Rigveda. In one of the suktas, a rishi says that I want to meet Aditi because she is both a father and a mother to me. I think this is a statement, you know, where the power of or empowerment of woman, it's so clearly seen that she is both the father and mother. Aditi literally means, a is negative. So without, diti is fetters. There are no limitations at all. And that itself defines the position of women in the society, because you always create gods and goddesses on the model of what you see in the society. And therefore, Aditi becomes important. There are others like Raka, Kuhu, Siniwali, and all the rivers, but we won't go into details of all of them. But I do want to say something about Usha. All of you know the word Usha. Usha is dawn, right? Now, please remember, 5,000 years back, in the winter, in the northern parts of India and even beyond that, when it used to be severe cold, when the dawn comes up, signaling the advent or the rise of sun, which brings not only light, but even heat, and also impelling, tat savitur varenyam. That's what we say. So when that happens, Usha becomes their goddess, right? They pay respect to her. Now, the most important thing is Usha, unlike Aditi, who is a mother goddess, is a young maiden. She's a beautiful young girl, according to all the rishis, and they vie with each other to describe her beauty. She's compared to a dancing girl. She's compared to a girl who is always young, who always looks young, you know. Jayamana Purani. So even though she's born every day, she's always young and all. I must tell you one nice thing. We have some wrong conceptions about our scriptures. They are full of life, especially Rig Veda is full of life. Usha, at one point, all the rishis have different approaches, right? Now, I mean, everybody sees at the same phenomenon or event or a goddess from different angles. One rishi says, Usha is also a mother goddess. For the simplest reason that first she comes and then gives birth to Surya. Naturally, mother comes first and gives birth to the sun. The other one, the other young rishi, who is more like a Rasika rishi, he says, no, Usha is a young maiden. And sun always chases her, you know, just like Maryo Nayosha Abhieti Paschat. Just like a young boy chases a beautiful girl, similarly, sun always chases Usha. Can you believe that this is a verse, this is a mantra which comes from Rig Veda? And then again, most of the times what they describe is her beauty and how she impels the people to work. And that's why I said, Ya Devi Sarva Bhuteshu Shakti Rupena Samsthita. It is their power, it is their strength. By no standards or no description will ever paint them as weak or shy or meek. You know, they are very different. Exactly on the lines of Usha, when you come to Rig Veda society and you see the young girl who is born in the family. Now we know that even in 2020, our Honorable Prime Minister had to give slogans like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao and all those things. Because there is a huge, big section of society who doesn't want a child, girl child. But in Rigvedic society, the girl was always welcome. In fact, there is a description that a father, when he comes back from work in the field, there are two twin sisters who sit on his lap and they are happily playing together. Jami Swasara is the word which is used. Another place, a man, a happy man is described as having putrinata kumarina. So he had sons and many daughters. So everywhere you will see that a girl was welcome. And that itself, if you have a secured childhood, if you are always welcome in the society, it gives you confidence, it gives you self-esteem, which takes you a long way throughout your life, right? I'm sure you will agree with me. There are some words for this girl child, you know, like Duhita. Duhita is the one who milks the cows. Yeah. So probably that was her main work in domestic chores. They also used to weave clothes. They also used to cook. All these descriptions I can show you from the Rig Veda. And what is very important is they also used to take education. Now you would say, how do I know that? Because there are references to rishis, that is the female rishis, the women rishis, who have composed suktas and they are included in Rig Veda. There are 21 such rishis who are women. Did you ever know that?
Not before I started my research, but after research I came to know, and I was really surprised कि इतनी सारी विमेन, मतलब जिस ऋग्वेद को हम यू नो इट्स अ प्राइमरी सोर्स ऑफ नॉलेज, सो मेनी विमेन हैव कंट्रीब्यूटेड,
राइट, सो मेनी विमेन हैव कंट्रीब्यूटेड एंड दे आर अमेजिंग, लाइक श्रद्धा और इंद्राणी श्री एंड देयर मेनी अदर्स, सो व्हिच शोस दैट दे वर ऑल एजुकेटेड एंड दैट मेक्स अ ह्यूज डिफरेंस बिकॉज the next stage when a girl is growing up and is educated, you come to a turn where you will get married. Now this again is a very important thing for a woman. A woman was not looked at as something to be enjoyed. A woman was supposed to be a wife to the man, right? And that is more important, because what is vivaha, what is marriage? All over the world, marriage is something like an agreement, you know. You sign two papers and you become husband and wife. Ours is the only culture, ours is the only religion where marriage or vivaha is what we call samskar, right? And how were the marriages decided? Do you think they were forced on these girls? Even in 21st century, many such things happen. Forced marriage. No, the girls chose their own husbands. Remember the word Swayamvara? Draupadi, Sita, they all had Swayamvara. That had started from Rigveda itself. And it tells you that these girls, they would wear good clothes, deck themselves up, make hairstyle chatushka parda, yuvati supesha, wear heavy brocades, and they would go to a gathering which is called samana. Now just remember, the society is sending the young girls to a gathering where there are young boys also, and they would talk to each other. You just cannot, I was like shocked, you know. I said, where has this society gone now? Why isn't there no transparency now? And where is the faith gone? Because the parents trusted the girls and their boys, and the society also trusted them, all this could happen. So the girls would go there and then come back and tell the parents, I want to marry Mr. and Mrs. So, Mr. So-and-so. So just imagine this, that they, in fact, in one of the suktas of Atharva Veda, it says, if the girl is educated, yuvanam vindate patim, then she gets young, but which means handsome, more handsome husband, if the girl is educated. Just imagine that. This is something which is impossible to believe for the first time, you know, but this is how it was. And when they got married, there is an entire Vivaha Sukta in the Rigveda. And in that Vivaha Sukta, there are references how the marriage was solemnized, how Vivaha was solemnized. You will be surprised that many of the customs, almost all the customs in that Sukta and many of the mantras from that Sukta are used still in the ritual where the way we get married today. So I always feel, and I have come always believed, you know, that the tradition of Rigveda has not stopped. It is not something like cut and throw. No, it goes on. The only thing, you know, it now works as an undercurrent, and it is our duty. It is our duty to show this to our younger generation and to take this to our children and grandchildren and show them what our real culture is. Please remember, it's your duty. I'm doing my share anyway. So this vivaha was very important. And I'll give you only one example. There is one mantra called Subangali Riyam Vadhu Imam Sameta Pashyata. that is this vadhu, this bride, is very auspicious. Please come and see her and give her saubhagya, that is everything which is auspicious. You will be surprised. This vidhi or this procedure is followed in the south of India even today. And it is called Subangali Darshana. Even the word comes from Rugveda. Or there is another reference which tells us that the marriage is not consummated for 4 nights. And it is on the 5th night that it happens. But this custom is followed in Bengal even today. And the mantras, the remaining mantras, Guru Bhadamite, Saubhagatvaya, Hastam and all, they are always there. There is also a reference to call something called Vahatu. Vahatu is a procession of the husband and wife. At least the place where I come from in Maharashtra, there used to be this, which used to be called Varat. You know, after the wedding, the bride and the groom, they would sit in a decorated vehicle, Vahatu. This decoration of the vehicle comes even in Rigveda, and they would go home. When she comes home, the husband says, let us stay in this house. Let us never be separated. Ma viyoshta. And we will play. We will first have garhapatya. That is, hum yaha sansar karenge. Or we will have our children, grandchildren, and great grandchildren in this house. So just imagine such a long life and healthy life. Then the husband says to the wife, oh wife, this is your father-in-law, this is your mother-in-law, sister-in-law and brother-in-law. He uses all the word Devru, Nanandru, Shvashru and all those things. And he says, from now onwards, you are the queen, Samrani Shvashure Bhava. You are the queen in the sense you are responsible for the happiness of this house. Doesn't mean you are the king, means you take a whip in your hand and discipline everybody. No, but you are responsible for the welfare and for the betterment and happiness of this house. I really like that. But the best thing I like about that is the husband says, let our hearts come together. So it is not only a union of two bodies, you know. For us, it has never been that. It is a union of two minds. At one point, the priest says, Dashasyam putran adhehi pratimeka dasham kuru. May the God give her 10 sons. 10 is many. But the funnier part is, give her 10 sons because husband is going to be her 11th son. And those wives who are now beyond 40, they would know how the husbands really behave like a child, you know. And we have to take care of him. So vivaha is a very important juncture. And then henceforth, this wife, she is with the husband in every way, in every field. She is there with rites and rituals. She is there to do her work in the fields. She works in the agriculturally also. She knew everything, so she would work there. There is a reference, you know, there are references that women also fought in the war. I mean, these are only references, and I think that society was so honest and genuine that there is no reason why they would give us sort of false information, fake news, as it is, the world is getting very common these days. They never did that at all. So there is one reference which I must tell you. There is a Rushi called Mudgala, and his wife is Mudgalani. This Rushi wanted to go somewhere, okay? And he told his wife, he told Mudgalani, I'm tired of driving. Why don't you ride me, take me in the car, in the ratha, that is, and reach me somewhere, wherever. And then Mudgalani agreed. Why I tell you this is that girls used to know how to ride a chariot or how to ride a vehicle, let's say. I remember when I was in college, there were, and in a place like Pune, which is supposed to be culturally advanced city, there were hardly 5 or 6 girls who could ride a two-wheeler, a scooter, forget about motorcycle. And even today in India, in places, rural areas and other areas, women don't do all these things. But of course, on that, at the same time, we have women who are even flying fighter planes in India now. So please remember, these fighter pilots, women fighter pilots, they stand on the shoulders of women like Mudgalani. So this Mudgalani not only rides the chariot, but she's going so fast that her Uttariya is this, right? Uttariya is fluttering in the wind. She's that fast. So just imagine what a beautiful society it is. Then, of course, motherhood is something which is very important. And many women, kind of true that motherhood, matrutva, gives their lives a complete dimension. It's an entirely different dimension. And once, you know, my 9-year-old granddaughter told me, I was talking to her, I said, don't worry, girls can do everything which a boy does. So don't worry. She said, yeah, but boys can't do everything which a girl does. I said, no, they can do. She said, no, they can't give birth to a baby. So this srujana shakti or creativity, it's not only delivering a baby, but this srujana shakti is unique to women. And as a mother, Rugvedic Mubari, just like you and me, they are so proud of their children. There is this Indrani. Indrani is the wife of Indra. We all know Indra. He is a Rugvedic god. So Indrani, her sukta is something I might go a little deeper into that, Vaishali, if you don't mind. And she says, Aham Ketu Raham Murdha Aham Ugra Vivachani. She says, I am the Ketu. Ketu is flag. Yeah, and she says, flag, what do you mean by flag? This house is known by me, not by Mr. Indra, but Mrs. Indrani. That is what she says. Aham Murdha. Murdhan is head. Who is the head of the family? Indrani is head of the family. Aham Ugra Vivachini. Ugra, you know the word. I speak a little harshly, you know. I don't care. Whatever is truth, I would speak that. And this way, if Indrani had the courage to say all these things, and if the Rishis had the courage to include this in the Samhita, in the text of the Rigveda, that itself speaks volumes about the role and position of women in the Rigvedic society. But very importantly, this Indrani, when she's talking about her son and daughter, she says, see, all mothers, they believe that their child is the best in the world. And which is true, you know, in a mother's eye, the child is the best child in the world. She says, Indrani, Mama Putro Shatruhana Atho Me Duhita Virat Mama Putraha. My son is Shatruhana. The word is same as Shatrughna. That is, he kills the enemies, which means he is a very brave soldier. Atho, and not only that, Me Duhita, my daughter. And that Indrani doesn't have enough words to describe the greatness of her daughter. And therefore she says, Virat. We know the word Virat. Virat is something, you know, for which there is no proper word in English. It is not only limitless or extensive or big or anything. Virat is Virat or big, both qualitatively and quantitatively. In Gita, we have this Virata Rupa Darshana. Many of you must have known that. So as a mother, Indrani is just like you and me. And that is what I like the most about Rigvedic women. That, you know, they are down to earth. They are welcome in the family. They learn everything. They educate. They're weaving, for example, you know, that is one thing which is very famously described in Rig Veda. All the girls, they would have what we call vaat and weft, that is tana or bana, okay? And they would weave clothes. And of course, unless and until somebody wove clothes, people, what will people wear, you know? So they would, that was their major thing. And they also knew embroidery. Can you believe? There are references that the girls have embroidered some designs on their clothes, especially the ones which they wear when they go to that samana, the gathering, with a gold thread, jari work, as we call it, you know, jari work. So they do that. And how do they do that? Sucha achidya banaya, with a needle which does not break. So the needle was strong. We don't know. We haven't got any archaeological site for Rig Veda as yet. But I'm hopeful that someday we will find a site and we will also find this suchi, the needle, which cannot be broken. Just imagine their knowledge of metallurgy. Anyway, coming back to this embroidery, I talked about this Vivaha Sukta, right? And what is Vivaha Sukta there? It's a lot of things I told you. But the bride, she wears a, what in Marathi we call shela, a covering thing, you know, on her sari, or not exactly sari, but the, whatever they used to wear. And that is very rich and heavily brocaded. That is called shamulya. The only sad part is, you know, I mean, I know how every one of us, all the women, or even men for that matter, they value their costume or dress which they have worn for their vivaha. But here, you know, that cloth has to be given away to the priest. How sad. But the most important thing is, the vadhu had to weave the shamulya herself. So just see, that means that the vadhu must be good in weaving, must be good in embroidery, must be good in education, cooking. There are references to cooking, which I haven't mentioned at all. She must bring up her children very well, and she must take care of the joint family which existed even in Rig Veda. And this is very important because there are some salient features of Indian society, and joint family is one of them. We all know that. But what is very important is, even in those days, there were joint families. And now what we have is nuclear families. And I always feel, you know, whenever the families are nuclear, there are more chances of having a nuclear explosion. So it's better. There are some goods of, and good and bad points about both, but joint family is always better. So now you would realize that, as they say later on in Vivaha Mantra, dharme, arthe, kame, in all the three purusharthas, this Vedic woman always stood by her husband. She stood by her family. She stood by her children. And what is very important is, she stood by herself. She always walked with her head, not like this, not down, but she always faced upwards, because not only because she was a good person herself, but because the society treated her well. I love movies. And many of you must have seen a movie called My Fair Lady. And there, this heroine, Eliza Doolittle, she says something and which is very important. All the women, please pay attention. Eliza says, I mean, there is one person who treats her like dirt, and there is another person who treats her as if she is a great lady. And she says, a woman becomes a lady, not because she behaves like one, but also because she is treated like one. And I would emphasize the point one more time, that Rigvedic woman was treated so well, with such great respect, affection, love by the entire society and her family, that this is my favorite dream, you know. I really dream that if I ever get a time machine, instead of going into 24th century or something, I would go back to Rig Veda and mingle with my Rig Vedic sisters. Thank you very much.
Very, very interesting, Sujata ji. But there are many questions I got because you prompted me quite a few thoughts. First of all, you mentioned some of the professions which where women were there. So if I want to connect the women of today, so the way they are in very different professions, which professions were difficult for women in the past and how did they tackle it? I mean, professions do you think it was difficult?
Okay, I'll tell you one thing. In those days, the professions, whether for men or women, were limited, right?
Yes, yes.
But of course, there are some things where you need physical strength, okay, that a woman could not do, neither in Rigvedic times nor today. Like, even if you have to pick up a heavy load or luggage, a woman even today is not able to do that. But whenever there is something which can be done on intellectual level, emotional level, or like I told you, riding a chariot and taking part in a war or something, a small battle is something which they did. They also wrote mantras. So there must have been some where the women did not. Even today, there are some professions where a woman cannot take part, participate for the simplest reason that nature has made her a little bit physically weak. But it does not become a deterrent for her, neither today nor in Rigvedic times.
Today's time, the way women are questioning that, you know, we live in a society which is very backward, which is not giving equality to women. How do we clarify their doubts? You have explained a lot of things wonderfully. But then also, I still have one doubt that how do we tell them that Indian women, whether it is in the past or in the present, they are much more superior, much more powerful, and they've got much more rights and power in the house compared to anywhere in the world.
I must say one thing. First of all, I would request all the listeners to read. I don't expect you to read Rig Veda, right? It is a difficult task, but you can read the translations. Rig Veda is translated in almost all the languages in the world. There are wonderful English translations which are available even on the net. So read the translations. And if you need, I can help you in that, which suktas or which poems should be read, which poems should be studied. I'll help you with that. So once you study the original, what happens is, I have always felt, Vaishali, that I'm ashamed to admit this, but we don't know our own religion. We don't know our own culture, but we know how to say bad things about it. And we are very much sure how to blame it. And you are blaming something which you don't know. So first get to know that. And I'm very sure that if you know what is Rig Veda, not only about women, but even about many other things, if you know about that, then you will love it. You will love it because it is a beautiful thing, you know. And believe me, whatever is very simple is always very beautiful also. So that is what I would say, that first read the translations and then make your own opinions. Oh, we have a very young listener today with us. So first read the translations and then form your opinions about it. Would you agree, Vaishali, with this?
No, sometimes he wants to be with me all and sit on my lap.
That's good. That's good. You know, right from childhood, he's listening to great thoughts.
Oh, yes. He listens to a lot of things. A lot of times he's there. And when he's not very cranky, I let him sit on my lap and listen. I would switch off my video and I let it happen. Of course, you know how the child is. And he sometimes he's cranky. Today, he's played so much that he wants to, you know, rest. I think it's time for him to sleep. So another thing which I wanted to ask you is, ouch, beta. Hey, leke jao isko, 2 minute. Another thing, very interesting thing which I noticed from your talk is, women have these apprehensions about certain professions. You know, typical certain professions where they think that they were not given equality or equal rights or equal remuneration. So how was the remuneration?
To be honest, there are no references to remuneration. Mm-hmm. I mean, not even about the remuneration given to men. Because, you know, this is poetry. Poetry in the sense, true poetry. Poetry based on facts.
True.
Right? And there are so many things which may not be mentioned in Rig Veda. That doesn't mean they did not exist. Get my point? So there must have been something, but we don't know about that.
Okay.
There are only 1,028 suktas, Vaishali, in Rig Veda. So how much can we know? But see, since Rig Veda is there, we are aware of our traditions, which are thousands of years old.
That is true.
Which is so amazing. And that is why I would say that, yes, there are things which might not be happening, but you can't be so sure about that.
Yeah, I'm sure.
There is no reference.
Okay. Let me check if there are any comments or any feedback from everyone, because I generally don't allow users to ask questions, because most of the time they don't ask questions. They just make the comment. Okay, lovely. Okay, so another question I want to ask you is, when we talk about women in the history, not in Rig Veda, but even in the medieval time or even in last 2000 years, I would like you to give me at least one or two examples where you think they were the best torchbearer for today's women.
Okay, I'll tell you the example right from Vedic literature, from Upanishads. Hmm. You all must have heard names of Maitreyi and Gargi Vachaknavi. They were great philosophers, and Gargi was such a great philosopher that she almost defeated a man named Yajnavalkya in philosophical discourse.
Yes.
This is Upanishads.
Yes.
So, which is quite old. I mean, immediately after Vedic Samhitas, after Rig Veda, you have Upanishads. So, this is one example. And then I will come to epics. I do not want to say much about Puranas and Smritis, because that's an entirely different game altogether. But even in the epics, just look at Draupadi.
Mm.
Have you ever realized what a person she was? A fiery woman who always enkindled the ambition of her husbands, and she got everything that she wanted. And she was amazing. I always call her, everybody else is Naika. She is Mahanaika. Draupadi is Mahanaika. For one thing, she is the Naika of Mahabharat. And she really is amazing, fascinating,
interesting.
Very nice. So these are some of the women. I mean, there are so many, but I think I will...
Yeah, okay. But the reason I'm asking you is I want today's women to get inspired from our all these women who were there in the past. So That's what I said.
Now that women are learning, or they get high education and advanced education and all, please remember that you are standing on the shoulders of Gargi, Maitreyi, and Aditi, and all those people. All the women who are doing so much, maybe it is in art or Vaishali like you, you know, you are spreading knowledge everywhere. Please remember that even in Vedic times, women have done this.
Oh,
and
wow.
Nowadays, we talk about multitasking, right?
Right.
Don't you think a Rigvedic woman was also doing multitasking, right? Yeah. From writing poetry to cooking for the entire family. She was doing everything. In Sanskrit, there is a verse which I don't exactly like, but you know, they say that a woman had so many qualities, whether she's from Rigveda or whether she's from 2020. And the verse goes like, Karyeshu Mantri, Shayaneshu Rambha, Yasteshu Mata. You probably know this. So a husband expects everything from woman, and the best part is the woman is able to satisfy his expectations. And that is why I say hats off to women who can do everything.
That is very true. And especially this last verse you have mentioned, when I was studying and I came across this verse, I was really surprised that how much power, how much talent, and how much, blessings of the Almighty, that women were able to do so much. But the problem which I see today is that because of their profession, communication gap, and the ego, because of that, lots of working women are getting out of relationships. They are facing divorces.
No.
They are, you know, out of the place. So for this kind of women, what would you like to advise?
Yeah, I would just like to advise that please do not confuse freedom with liberty.
True.
You have been given freedom. Use it with discretion. Whatever Lakshman Resha is drawn for you, please remain inside. Sita crossed that and we know what happened, right? So whatever the Lakshman Resha, I mean, it is not anybody's fault, but these are the demands of society and time, and we have to accept them because we live in a society, so accept them. And what you say about relationship and all, you know, it is so difficult. See, there is we don't even have a word for divorce in Rigveda or Vedic literature at all. This idea is entirely foreign and entirely it's entirely a modern thing, which we have blindly borrowed from the West. It is not our culture. It is not our idea. But nowadays, people are changing a lot, but still, try to look at the Vedic woman and try to let the Vedic woman be your model, your ideal, and you will really enjoy yourselves.
I don't find it inferior. I don't find it in any ways. We were lesser, and because
a lot of
people have felt that, you know, Indian women are lesser smart, less educated, less informed compared to the Western world. And that is that is the myth which I also want to break wherever I go, because people don't understand the difference only.
They say this because they are jealous of Indian women.
Actually, you are right. That also I've come across. They always say that can we replace our positions? They always say that.
And that is what I mean. If you have your self-esteem and if you have your self-confidence, you will grow to be an Aditi. A person, a woman, without any fetters, without any limitations.
True.
There is your kartrutva, as we say, you know, has no bounds if you have self-esteem, if you have self-confidence. And that comes with your education, your samskaras, your thought process, and your family and society. So let us follow that. And India has never had a Women's International Day, you know. For us, they respect women all through the year. Exactly. Or it is not like 8th March, give them flowers and whatever, and the remaining 364 days, forget about them. We never have that. So this is the real respect that our society has shown for women. And I'm grateful to the society, Rigvedic society, by the way. I'm grateful to Rigvedic Society for doing this.
Lovely. Okay. Suchitaji, thank you so much for your time. And I'm so happy that you could clarify many of my doubts. And I really want this conversation to go forward. And I want people to know, especially our viewers, that how women were perceived as in our scriptures, in our past, and what we need to learn from them in today's time. So thank you. Thank you so much for your time. I hope to see you again whenever possible.
I really wish you all the luck in your future ventures. Because like I said, you are doing a great job. Thank you for that.
Thank you.